As she has explained how NMAP works and how it is used for host discovery and port scanning. Now I am going to talk about the Nessus tool. Nessus is an open source software vulnerability scanner tool. It is used for finding the vulnerabilities in a specific web application, or it can be used for finding the vulnerabilities in a target host. It can also be used for finding to discover which hosts are alive in the network and then perform a port scan on those hosts. Another feature of Nessus is it can scan a Windows system to identify or detect which malwares are sitting on that system. Now we will have a look at the Nessus tool. I have already installed Nessus tool in my system. The installation is quite straightforward, and the instructions are given on their home page. Here you have to enter your username and password. And this is the home page of the Nessus. Here you can see there are different tabs: scans, schedules, policies. So to start with the Nessus, first of all you should understand what is the flow of the Nessus. Here you should first create a policy, and then using those policy you can scan your using those policy you can create a scan. You can do a scan on the target system or target web application. So what is a policy? Policy is basically a set of plugins, and these plugins check for vulnerability in the target host or target web application. So there are already thousands of plugins in the Nessus. You can see those plugins over here. There are many plugins, and have a look at this plugin, CGI abuses XSS. So what is XSS? XSS is cross-site scripting. It is a software vulnerability that is found in web application. So this plugin will try to find XSS vulnerability in the web application. So this is a plugin, this is actually a plugin family, and it has this many plugins inside this family. It has 554 plugins inside this family. So first of all, in the Nessus you have to create a policy and then use this policy in creating a scan. So how to create a policy? Go to the policies, click on the new policy, and as you can see there are many options available here: host discovery, basic network scan, web application test, Windows malware scan, and there are many more. So depending on what type of scan you want to do, you should choose an appropriate policy. Suppose you want to discover which hosts are alive and do a port scanning on it. So you can choose that host discovery policy. You should give a policy name, say host discovery. Visibility, private or shared. When the visibility is shared, then it is shared among other users on the system. Then click next. Discover type, host enumeration. Host enumeration, it will just check whether the host is alive or not. There is also option for port scan, all ports or common ports. So depending on them, you can perform a scan. Since this was already done in the NMAP, so I'm not going to do it again. Let's have a look at another policy, say basic network scan. This policy is used to find a vulnerability in the target host. First of all, using the host discovery, you are finding which hosts are alive and which ports are open in that host. Now using basic network scan, you are going to find the vulnerabilities in those hosts. So in order to create this policy, select this one, give the policy name basic network scan, select the visibility private or shared, next. Here the scan type, internal or external. Depending on the scan type, a specific set of plugins will be enabled. And then just click on the next and the policy will be created. Here, yeah, if you are going to scan a system which has Windows operating system, then you are required to give the username and password of that system. Okay. And if it is a Linux system, then provide the password, root username is always root and password of that Linux system. And then click on the save. So the policy will be created in this way. I have already created this policy, internal network scan. We have policy internal network scan, scan type internal, and this is an optional step actually, step 3, where you have to, you can or cannot provide credentials. Now once you have created the policy, we are going to perform a scan, we are going to launch a scan. So let's go into the scan tab, and when you want to launch a scan, click on the new scan, give one name, say right now we are going to use basic internal network scan policy for in this scan. So let's give a name, internal network scan. Specify the policy that you are going to use, internal network scan, folder my scan, and specify the target on which you are going to perform this this network scan. So you can specify the IP address of a single host, or you can specify the IP address of a range of hosts. Like if you want to scan a single host, then you will specify 192.168.2.22.1, or and if you want to scan a range of hosts, then you will specify 192.168.22.0/24. So it is going to scan 255 hosts in that range, and then just click on the launch button. So it will launch a scan. I have already results of this internal network scan. So I am not going to do it again because this scan takes a little time. So I scanned one system which has this IP address 10.129.154.1. I did a basic network scan, basically internal network scan on this host, and it shows that there are 5 critical vulnerabilities, 1 high vulnerability, 2 medium level vulnerabilities, 1 low, and other is informational. So this shows that what is the criticality of the vulnerabilities that are present in the host. So when you click on it, it will show all the vulnerabilities that is present in the target host. Here as you can see, it also shows what is the operating system that is being used on that host. So here the Microsoft Windows XP is used with the Service Pack 2 and Service Pack 3. Now let's have a look at the vulnerabilities. So select this one, Microsoft Windows XP unsupported installation tree. That it says that the remote host is running Microsoft Windows XP. Support for this operating system by Microsoft has ended by April 20th. So this means that this is an outdated Windows XP, and therefore the Microsoft is no longer creating or producing patches for the vulnerabilities that are found in XP. So if there are any new vulnerabilities that are found in XP, then it is going to harm your system, and there are no patches for it. So it is also providing a solution, upgrade to a version of Windows that is currently supported. This was just a simple vulnerability. There are also technical vulnerabilities, such as, let's take this one, MS0067. It says that the remote host is vulnerable to a buffer overrun in the server service that may allow an attacker to execute arbitrary code on the remote host with the system privileges. So what this vulnerability means is there is a C program in the Windows XP server. The name of that C program is netapi32.dll, and in that program there is this buffer overflow vulnerability, and the attacker may abuse that vulnerability. Okay. There is a C program in Windows XP server which has this vulnerability, buffer overflow vulnerability, and the attacker may abuse that vulnerability. So this was about the network scan, basic network scan. Now suppose you want to let's create another policy, say web application test. So this policy is used for scanning the website to find different vulnerabilities that exist in the website, such as SQL injection or XSS attack or something. So if you have got your own website and you want to check whether it is secure or not, then you can use this policy, web application test. So in order to create this policy, select this one, web application test, give the policy name, visibility, private or shared, next. Here, scan type, less complex or more in depth, it will scan accordingly. Web mirroring start pages, here you have to specify the URL of the website that you are going to scan. And then next. Here you have to specify the URL of the website that you are going to scan. So specify the URL of the website, and this is an optional step where if the website requires user credentials, means if the website requires username and password, then you can provide it over here in this login page, HTTP login form, you can provide username and password in this form. And then just click on the save button and the policy will be created. I have already created this policy for scanning one website called HTTP www.insecurelabs.com.org. So this is the policy that I have created. So policy name Insecure Labs. Next, I have specified the URL of the website, and it doesn't require any username and password. So I haven't specified anything. Now, once this policy is created, now you can launch a scan to scan the target website, that website. Then click on the new scan. Name, again, web application test, specify the policy, that is the policy that you have created, this one, Insecure Labs, specify the policy that you have created, and again you have to specify the URL of the website in the target, means same URL of the website, and then click on the launch, and this scan takes quite a long time. So I have this scan results already stored. So this was the website that I had scanned using that policy. So it says that there are 6 medium level vulnerabilities and 24 informational vulnerabilities. So when you click on it, you will get a list of the vulnerabilities that are existing in that website. So as you can see, let's check this vulnerability. It says that the remote web server host CGI script that failed to adequately sanitize request strings with malicious JavaScript. It means that this website is vulnerable to XSS actually. We had checked manually and we saw that this website is vulnerable to XSS. And now using the Nessus tool, it was able to find that, okay, that website is now vulnerable to this. Using this Nessus tool, it was able to find that vulnerability. These XSS are likely to be non-persistent or reflected. So using such policies, you can scan a website that you want. Now, when you select a particular policy, a set of plugins are automatically enabled. But if you want to create your own policy where you want to specify which plugin should be enabled, you can go to the advanced policy and here give the name and everything, name of the policy that you are creating, and there are different options, port scanning, performance, the number of hosts it must check in one scan, different option you can specify. And here is the plugin that you can enable or disable. So by default, all plugins are enabled. So suppose you want to create a policy that is going to scan for malware in the system, in the target system. So obviously you don't want all of the plugins to be enabled because it will take a long time if they all are enabled. So you can filter the plugins using this. There is an option for filter plugins. Specify plugin name, contents, say malware, then it will show all the plugins that has a malware in their name and apply. So it is searching for all the plugins that has a malware in their name. It will show 4 to 5 plugins that can be used for this malware scene. It takes see here. These are the results. Now here there are 5 plugins that has a name malware in their name. So this is the plugin. So you have got a set of plugins that can be used for finding the malwares in the target host. So using this is a great tool for like finding the vulnerabilities in the application as well as in the target host in your networks.
Let's open the floor to questions.
Can we check the application which is in the LAN, or we can check the application?
Yeah.
In the LAN also.
Yeah, in the LAN also. You have to specify.
It's on private IP.
Yeah. You have to specify the IP, then followed by that.
Private IP.
Yeah.
Shall we add plugins? User defined plugins.
No, you can't add plugins actually. There are already a list of plugins that are downloaded when you're installing this Nessus tool. And you can just enable or disable.
Are creating policies, no? Like yeah. We can add plugins.
You can't add plugins. You can choose plugins, but you can't add plugins. Plugins are downloaded from the server side actually. Here you can just enable or disable them. There isn't any option to add a plugin or create a plugin.
How to install and configure this?
Sorry?
How to install and configure this Nessus?
It is very straightforward actually. Just download the exe file and click on it. So it will go on.
So what about Ubuntu?
Sorry?
What about Ubuntu? Same process as we applied in the previous WireShark?
Yeah.
So for installation of all these softwares we are using, we will be giving you a VM which you can run on your VirtualBox. So this VM has already installed all the software we are using. So you can just load that VM inside VirtualBox and you can use those tools directly if you want to use these tools in your colleges. So you do not need any installation separately. Yes, all the tools we are using, we will be bundle them in a VM.
That you have scanned for buffer overrun and said that some particular DLL is has the yeah. So actually how it is done?
The information about that vulnerability is provided in that itself. When you will see that vulnerability, it has given the description about it, the solution. Microsoft has released a set of patches and C also. Then it has given one link where you can find the information about that vulnerability.
That means it just provided the information.
Yeah, it will provide an information.
It does did not penetrate into the victim.
Yes.
Which inside and analyze the DLL file. That is what.
No. It only checks for the suppose it knows that this vulnerability is present in XP system of this version. So it sees that version and say, okay, there is a file which is not patched and this has buffer overflow.
Sir.
The
vulnerability is compatible
by using this. Yeah. You have to just specify the IP address of that remote system.
Is it legal?
Yeah. If you're, it is legal. Like if you're doing it in your private network, then you can do it.
So if you are not attacking and you're not causing any harms, I think there's no harm in it.
This is just for finding the vulnerabilities.
So if why do you want? Okay. So tool is used for basically for your convenience only, for you checking for your web application. Like you have hosted of an application, you want to check if there is any vulnerability or not. There can be a negative thing also. So you want to attack google.com, say Gmail, then you will be using this scanner. So this means that you want to do some harm. So I think you should not do that. This tool is for your basically for your use, for your web applications to check if there are any vulnerabilities or not.
Sir,
I can find out what would be application.
Yes, you can check. But that is for it means you want to attack it, yeah, right? Because you want to find the vulnerability or you want to inform them.
Sir, suppose my machine is in the network, okay, and I don't want my machine to be get scanned. Okay. What shall I do?
Okay, yeah. So suppose, okay, you are asking that if there are host in your inside your system, inside your network, and somebody else is using this scanner, you want that to prevent, right? So you can use some firewall or some rules, and you specify the rules inside your firewall so that you, another host cannot scan your system.
There is definitely an ethical aspect to this whole thing. That is one of the reasons over the years, even though I've been teaching security again and again, I'm generally reluctant to start telling students in a huge class of 80 or 100 and so on to use all these, you know, EtherCAP, to do ARP spoofing or DNS spoofing and so on, because it can really create much havoc. So one of the questions, that is why I always keep only three or four students who I absolutely trust who will not do anything wrong. There was a time when one of my small group, actually two or three of my students, they were working with me, they set up a honeypot. And that honeypot was just sending messages in a crazy fashion. And then there were complaints from so many different people in the department that the network has slowed down, the system administrators and others, that I simply abandoned this entire project completely. So there are many aspects of creating a security lab. In fact, I've got a very good book on this, which I should share with you. It's not right now here with me, to create a security lab. The question is, who can use it? What are they doing with it? And so on and so forth. These are very, very, very critical issues, because as a faculty member, you set up this lab and your students do something wrong, the blame ultimately goes to you. Why did you set this lab up? Why did you tell them to do this? This is one of the problems that I've been facing personally. So what we do it in a very incremental way, just having two or three students do this thing. In fact, you will see that even in this lab that you are attending, we don't have you touch Nessus and Nmap and snort and so on and so forth. For one thing, many of these vulnerability scanners, they generate a great deal of traffic. So we thought about it and we agonized over it. We would like you to have hands-on experience with these tools, but then it generates so much traffic, 250 participants or 220 participants, that something is going to happen, the network is going to crash or something. So we said, okay, we'll just have demos and we will encourage you to install it in your colleges and interact with us about how things are going and so on and so forth. And regarding that other question about can you scan remote hosts? Most of these attacks, the starting point, the onset of these attacks is the first step, if I want to attack a machine, is scanning that particular subnet or that particular network, that remote network. So that is the best way to catch a hacker. You see who is trying to scan your internal network, whether it's a port scan or a network scan or any kind of vulnerability scan, see where it is coming from, try and trace that. And the best way to do that is something called an IDS device called a honeypot, which traps all these things. And the honeypot induces you to attack the network. Say I've got a honeypot that I've installed over here in our network. It induces hackers around, whoever wants to hack, to come into my network and start scanning and so on, to send certain worms and so on. And I trap those worms, and then I can do a study as to and see what are these possibly new mutants or worms that are being unleashed around the place, etc. So yes, about the remote scanning, is it legal? That was the question. Is it ethical? Is it legal, etc.? Frankly, I don't know which rules exist today that say it is illegal and it's illegal. I believe you can do it. I think we have done it on Google and so on, right? We have scanned Google to see what are the services that are exposed, etc., etc. So you can do it, provided you don't take it any step further, because otherwise the blame will come to you. So be very, very careful. We are treading on water actually over here. There was one gentleman in the audience from Amrita. Where is he? Oh, yes, yes. So he had a very nice discussion with me over lunch about the ethical issues about this and whether we can address that. And I really think this is food for thought. We really have to have a session on ethics. Maybe we can't do it by the time this workshop closes, but by the time we have the next workshop, we will put together ethics. I hope some of you will help me to put this together, because it's a common problem for all of us. How to make our students do ethical hacking without doing anything bad, without doing anything wrong, without spreading wrong information and teaching others to do something wrong, etc. So that's a very, very serious issue in this course. You don't have this problem in other courses. You teach operating systems or architecture or databases. All these things don't exist. But in security, you have to be very careful about who is doing what. There's a great opportunity to abuse things. Yes, any other questions? Anything on Nmap that Ritu Bala showed you? Yes.
Sir, once if he scanning some remote host and if he found the who is a hacker, then whom should we report?
Well, you can't just say somebody is a hacker just because he's scanning your network. I mean, you know, there could be spoofed scanning, for example, somebody else pretending to be this guy who's scanning. You have to be able to act, you know, trace the footprints very, very carefully. First, something has to be, some harm had to be done, has to be done to you. It's, scanning is not exactly a, you know, anything that's terribly bad. I mean, as I said, we have been scanning Google and so on, right? I mean, are we going to go to jail because of that? So you have to, that other party has to prove that you are guilty of something, of stealing information, of stealing credit cards, etc., etc. That becomes a big issue. That's a whole subject called forensics. Maybe Professor Shiva talked a little bit about it today. How do you catch, you know, how do they leave fingerprints? How do you, there are, I've got books on this, by the way. I've got a collection of about 70 books on security. One of them is actually forensics. How do you catch, after the act, how do you catch this person? What fingerprints has he left all over the place so that you can actually nail it down to him and say, you were the guy responsible for this thing. Yes.
Sir, is any case study for botnets?
Case study for botnets? Not one, but 10 or 20.
How to detect it and...
How to detect botnets? There are lots and lots of research papers right now. That's a very good area of research, actually. Not only the both of them, to create a botnet, ethical hacking, and to detect botnets. It's very likely, I always ask myself the question, how many of the laptops on this campus are bot infested? And it's probably a very large number. Monitoring everything you do, etc., etc. How do you figure all these things out? That's a very active area of research.
Regarding the software, you are going to, you are saying that you will give the bundles of the software.
Yes.
So is it a virtual OS image that we have to load in the virtual box?
Yes.
So I think that images will be machine specific. So will it run in on our machines also?
You have to dashen it on the virtual machine.
Yeah, but it will be configuration. It is specific to the machine and the configuration where that image is created. So will it that will it work on our machine and our configuration also?
Yes, it will work on your configuration because you will be using the virtual box. So this is a software which runs the operating system. So this does not depend on your hardware. So if the virtual box is you can run virtual box on your machine, then you can run this virtual machine also.
Otherwise, for this all software, I think Nessus, Wireshark, Nmap, for all those, means they are also available for Windows.
Yeah, they are also all available for Windows.
All the software, no?
Yes.
Okay.
Backtrack does not have the DVW and all, and some of... Yes. Backtrack have all the things, but some of them are not there, like DVW is not there, and some more. So we are using those, so we should include that also. Yes, it is also available on Windows. You can also install. If you want, we can give you instructions for installing the DVW inside the Windows.
Is it possible to have attacks even on systems that have antivirus?
That depends what the antivirus, if it is outdated and some new attacks are there, then it can obviously.
Instead of DVW, can we use a WebGuard?
Yes, you can use also WebGuard. WebGuard also has, I think, all the...
Yeah, it has all the top 10 vulnerabilities.
Yes, you can also use it. But we were using the DVW application more, so we shot that. WebGuard is also another option.
So I think with the Kali Linux, we could customize that. And all the softwares that you are mentioning could be fitted into a Kali Linux.
Yes. Kali Linux is a new version of the Backtrack, actually. Now Backtrack is outdated. It is another Backtrack, so they renamed it to the Kali Linux.
So if we create an customized Kali Linux ISO, then it would be light and it could include only this softwares.
Yeah, it could. So I think you all were working on the Ubuntu, so we thought that we will create the Ubuntu image, so this will have all the installation. So that was for your convenience. If you want, we can bundle all these software inside Kali Linux. It has many more software which we haven't showed you.
No, we have to create the lab session at our end.
Yes.
Can we install all systems with Ubuntu?
Yeah, sure. Why not?
Instead of going with two operating systems, can we practice only with one?
It's not necessary that only one operating system is through with that.
Okay. You suggest to have two, Windows as well as Open.
You can practice on either Windows or Linux.
We saying, do you need more than one?
Let it not create confusion so that we'll follow only one thing. Like,
yeah, okay, so we'll you just install Ubuntu. Yes, you just install the
because
Ubuntu.
Many tools are available for Ubuntu. Like your Wireshark is pre-installed in your Ubuntu.
Yes.
Nmap, all these things, they're backtrack.
Yes.
So shall we go for that Ubuntu?
Yeah, if you want, you can go for the Ubuntu. But in, like you said, that why Windows doesn't have Wireshark and Nmap pre-installed, so you have to reinstall them.
Because
that's
already
your options.
Most of the Windows operating system have been outdated. They are coming with Windows 7 and so on.
Yes, yes. Again, well, I think you should use the Ubuntu then.
Because better is yes. Go for Ubuntu, I think so.
Yes, yes.
Why ever? Final year students cannot attend the workshop. They are interested, BTEC final year students. It is clearly mentioned that only teachers can attend the workshop at remote centers.
So the question about whether students can attend, whether, you know, company people ask me, can they attend, and so on and so forth. The answer is, really speaking, the mandate from the ministry to us was to basically teach the teachers and to raise the standard of our colleges around the country. So you know very well that you know, the standard overall, maybe in, there are of course exceptions, but the overall standard is not that great. I mean, you just go around, at least here in the city of Bombay, so many people are thinking of sending their children abroad for further studies, for a bachelor's. Why? Why can't we give them quality education here itself? Why should they have to spend so many lakhs, tens of lakhs, to send their kids abroad for education? At a fraction of the cost, we can educate them, right? So the onus, the responsibility is on us to develop very good courses. And, you know, I would really like to see security pick up, and not only security, so many other courses, and have, you know, not just a few universities that are very great in India. We would like to have, you know, many, many, many universities that are good in India, because we have such a large population, 1.2 billion. If you compare it with the United States, for example, just look at the number of universities, you know, look at the top 100 or look at the top 50. Even the top 50, almost all of them have got good quality. Of course, the top 5 or the top 10 are absolutely terrific. But then the next 20 are very good, and so on and so forth. While people complain over here, you know, we don't, where do we send our child? He wants to go for medicine, but medicine is so expensive. We think of engineering, which college to send him to, and so on and so forth, if he doesn't get into IIT or this thing or that thing. And we really need to improve the quality of education in our colleges. I mean, we should have hundreds of colleges that are top quality, not just 10 or 15 or something like that, for a population like this, 1.2 billion. So the goal was to actually spread, you know, high level of education around. So we've got many such courses that we've organized. I think recently Professor Fatak had the programming course, C language programming. Professor Kameshwari had the networks course. Professor Sudarshan had the database course. So that, you know, we have quality in many, many colleges around. Now, of course, the one of the issues is, one of the things that people say is, why don't you bring them all to IIT Bombay and teach and so on? But of course, we can't bring, we can bring 200, but we can't bring 10,000 over here. It becomes very difficult to scale up. So this great idea came about where we will try to improve the quality in, say, 200 colleges, and each of you has the mandate, when you go back to your hometown, to your college, to bring 50 other people from 50 other colleges and train them and improve their standard greatly. That is why I'm so interested in, you know, I desire so much that this software be installed, you'll start using it, you'll start working on it. Unfortunately, we can't have you have hands-on experience over here for reasons I mentioned. But try to install it as soon as you can, try to get familiar with it, try to become a hero in this thing, and, you know, sort of train a few students of yours, maybe a few colleagues of yours, and eventually those 50 or whatever people from around your area, when they come to you in July, they should also become experts. Gradually, we should build more and more expertise. I would like to see a day when people say, India is one of the greatest in education, when people from around the world come to India to study. Here we have an exodus, people leaving and going here and there to study. We have very few people coming here. We've got few, we used to have few students from Ethiopia or some students from Cambodia or this or that. Few students coming. India is not the Mecca of education, especially higher education. We need to become that because we have huge amount of talented manpower. Why not harness this manpower You see so many, you go to the US, for example, I was there for 16 years. You go there and you see in every single university research lab, Indians doing very, very well. If there is so much talent, why don't we do that here itself? Only when we go there, we do well. When we are here, we don't. And education is not something so difficult that we can't do, right? If everyone puts in the hard work, we can be centers of excellence over here. So the thing is that we are very few for this population. How can we increase it? So that parents don't have to regularly complain and get worried, where am I going to send my child to? I mean, I've heard this at least 30 times. What do you think I should do? Where do you think he or she should go? Now, what do I answer? Tell me. It's so difficult to get into IIT. So then the person says, it's impossible for my child to get into IIT. The competition is so much. But at least if I had 20 names to say, you know, you could try this or this or this, and there's a fair chance of you getting, the quality is very good, it would be much more gratifying to me, right? I would feel less embarrassed to answer that question. So let us do this. Let's all get together over here and say within 1 year, our college is terrific in a whole bunch of different courses. Let us, you know, start the education thing and then let's move on to research, where India is then known as a research superpower. Because we have all this human talent, right? People yearning to study, people yearning to work, etc. Let's build them up as a formidable force. I mean, I make a simple statement. If Indians can do well when they are abroad, why not over here? Does anybody have the answer, satisfactory answer to that question? Why can't we create the conditions where our people flourish and thrive, are very productive? Are you doing great research in your colleges? How many people are doing great research amongst your colleagues, etc.? Are you publishing some great new ideas? Does the world know about those ideas? So that's the thing, right? If we should start by this education thing. I know some of you have done very good PhDs. I've been talking to some of you in the last 3 days, and I'm extremely impressed on the different things that you're doing. But we should have a larger number of those people for the population. So to answer your question, the mandate is not to bring students and everything, because that sort of, you know, is not really the mission. I mean, we would like to have as many students. We'll have no end to this. But at least the multiplicative effect, if we, you know, have 200 participants and then each of those 200 trains another 50, then straight away we've got 10,000 people trained through this two-phase thing. That is very good. Even if out of those 10,000, 2,000 are trained very well and they train their students, I think we are successful. And do this in many, many courses. So challenge yourself to be a hero in this subject and in other subjects, and also to make your college shine. Say we will go all out for excellence, and we'll compete with international universities. Why shy away from that? Let's see where we are 10 years if all of us resolve to do this. But it requires a huge, huge amount of work and huge amount of sweat.
Now there is a tea break for half an hour.